We have seen in the previous video how to represent sinusoidal plane wave in the form of instantaneous form and phasor form. The question now is, what would be the advantage, or what is the advantage of this phasor form? Effectively, the advantage of the phasor form arises from the fact that Maxwell's equation is relating the spatial derivative of the fields to the time derivative of the fields. And assuming that we are going to use the phasor form, so the time dependence would be separated from the spatial dependence such that the time dependence would be e to the power j omega. Now in this case, if we are assuming that we are going to take the derivative of the electric field in its phasor form, so we are going to take the derivative of e to the power j omega t only. And the derivative of e to the power j omega t equals j omega multiplied by e to the power j omega t. So effectively, the derivative with respect to time in time domain or instantaneous form corresponds in phasor form to just multiplying by the factor j omega. So in this case, the relations between the spatial derivative of the electric field and the time derivative of the fields can be represented as the spatial derivative of the fields with j omega multiplied by the other field components. So in this case, instead of presenting the differential equation in terms of both time and space, we are going to represent it only in the terms of space. And the time is inherently included in the function e to the power j omega t, and its derivative is just can be replaced by multiplication by the term j omega. In a similar way, the integration with respect to time, it can be replaced by 1 over j omega. So assuming that we have the relation between hy and ex in time domain as the derivative of hy with respect to z equals minus epsilon naught partial ex by partial t, this representation in time domain or instantaneous form can be simplified in phasor form as the derivative of the phasor of hy, which is function only of z with respect to z, would equal minus j omega instead of partial by partial t, j omega epsilon naught multiplied by the phasor form of the electric field Ex. So in this case, this would be only ordinary differential equation in terms of the space or in terms of z only. Here it is partial differential equation in terms of time and z. Here it is ordinary differential equation in z only. So solving this ordinary differential equation would be much simpler than solving this partial differential equation in terms of z and t. Then after solving this ordinary differential equation, we can obtain the phasor form of the magnetic field, and by multiplying this phasor form of the magnetic field by e to the power j omega t and taking the real value, we can return to obtain the instantaneous form of hy. So we are going to solve the problem in phasor form in space only. And if you are interested to find out the instantaneous solution, we take the phasor form multiplied by e to the power j omega t and take the real value to obtain it as a function of time and space. Okay, so this would be our strategy in solving Maxwell's equation in free space for sinusoidal plane wave. It is valid only for sinusoidal plane wave or the time harmonic varying field. So it is only valid for time harmonic, not any time varying field, time harmonic only. Okay, so we can represent Maxwell's equation now instead of time varying field can be represented in phase of form for free space propagating function. So in this case we are going to replace any derivative with respect to time by j omega. So the phasor form of Ampere's law in free space would be curl Hs equals j omega epsilon naught Es. And here H is the magnetic field as a function of time and space. Hs is the magnetic field as a function of space, assuming that the time dependence is e to the power j omega. In a similar way, E is the electric field as a function of time and space. Es is the phasor electric field as a function of space only, and the time dependence is assumed to be e to the power j omega t. Okay? Now, Faraday's law would be presented in the phasor form as curl Es would be minus j omega, because we have minus here, and the derivative with respect to time would be j omega, minus j omega mu naught Hs. And Gauss law would be the same. The divergence of Es would be 0, and the divergence of Hs would be 0. Because actually, we are going to use the phasor form almost in every case. So, maybe after a while, we will ignore to write the letter S. But keep in your mind, this form is the phasor form. Is not the instantaneous form, and to obtain the instantaneous form after solving this form multiplied by e to the power j omega t and take the real value of this multiplication. Okay, now starting from the phasor form of Maxwell's equation, we are going to derive the general wave equation for the electric and magnetic field components. In this case, assuming that we are starting with Faraday's law, curl E equals minus J omega mu naught H, and let us take the curl of both sides. So in this case, curl Es would equal minus j omega mu naught curl Hs. But according to Ampere's law, curl Hs equal j omega epsilon Es. Right? Before taking this, let us first analyze this curl curl. This curl curl can be simplified as the gradient of the divergence of Es minus nabla squared Es. And more, I'm saying that the gradient of the divergence does not equal nabla squared. Alright? Okay. So, according to this, nabla dot Es from Gauss law equals 0. So, the remaining part here would be minus nabla squared Es. Now, curl HS can be replaced by J omega epsilon naught ES. So this can be replaced by J omega epsilon naught ES. J multiplied by minus J, it would be 1. And omega multiplied by omega, it would be omega squared. And the mu naught epsilon, so this is omega squared mu naught epsilon ES. Or, in other words, we can say that nabla squared ES would equal minus omega squared mu naught epsilon ES. And this omega squared mu naught epsilon, we are going to call it k naught squared, where k naught is omega square root mu naught epsilon. Or in other words, in terms of C, k naught would equal omega over C, where C is 1 over the square root mu naught epsilon. So, in this case, the relation between the electric field and the electric field, here, the advantage of this derivation is that instead of the electric field in terms of magnetic field or magnetic field in terms of the electric field, here the relation of the electric field with respect to the electric field. The relation between the electric field and the electric field is nabla squared ES or nabla squared of the electric field equal minus k naught squared of the electric field. This is known as Helmholtz equation, and this Helmholtz equation is effectively the wave equation of time harmonic fields. The wave equation of time harmonic fields. And it should be noted that this is a partial differential equation in space only. So we have the derivative with respect to x squared plus the derivative with respect to y squared plus the derivative with respect to z squared. So here we have the special derivative of the electric field is a function of the electric field. So by solving this differential equation, we can find the electric field or the phasor electric field as a function of the space. And previously we know that its function as a function of time is e to the power j omega t. So by solving this equation, we can find out the electric field as a function of space. This effectively is a general function for the total electric field. So here the electric field, we have x component, y component and z component. And because it is 1-to-1, so nabla squared Ex would equal minus k naught Ex. Nabla squared Ey would correspond to minus k naught Ey, and so on. So, assuming that we have x component only, as we mentioned in the previous plane wave, so nabla squared Ex would be minus k naught squared Ex. And in this plane wave, we assume that the electric field Ex, which is located in x direction, and it is uniform in the xy plane, so the derivative with respect to x and the derivative with respect to y would be zero. So the general form for nabla squared would be the derivative with respect to x squared plus the derivative with respect to y squared plus the derivative with respect to z squared equal minus k naught squared exs. And because we have a plane wave which is uniform in xy plane, so the first derivative with respect to x is 0, the second derivative with respect to y is 0, so nabla squared E equal minus k naught squared E in the case of a plane wave with field component Ex and which is uniform in xy plane would be only the derivative of Ex with respect to z squared equals minus k naught Ex. So this is the Helmholtz equation or the wave equation for a plane wave for Ex component, which is uniform in XY plane or which is propagating in Z direction. So assuming a plane wave in which Ex doesn't vary in XY, we have only this function, this derivative with respect to Z or function of Z. Now it is required to find out the solution of this function. Effectively, this second order differential equation and second order differential equation has two solutions. So these two solutions, I'm not going to derive the solution, but I'm going to say that assume that the solution is Ex naught multiplied by e to the power minus jk naught z. And let us see if this solution would satisfy this differential equation or not. So if we differentiate this function once with respect to z, would be minus jk naught multiplied by the same value. And if we differentiate it once again, it would be minus jk naught squared. So minus j multiplied by minus j, it would be minus. And k naught squared, so it would be minus k naught squared of the original value. So effectively, the function Ex naught multiplied by e to the power minus jk naught z satisfies the solution for this differential equation. And similarly, we can prove that the solution e dash multiplied by e to the power jk naught z, its first derivative would be the same function multiplied by jk naught. The derivative with respect to z, we will take this jk naught as a multiplication factor. If we make another derivative with respect to z, so the second derivative would be jk naught squared. J multiplied by j, it would be minus 1. K multiplied by k, it would be k naught squared. So the second derivative of this function with respect to z would equal the same function multiplied by minus q naught squared. So both these two functions, they are two different functions. They don't depend on each other, and both of them satisfy this wave equation. Effectively, we have other solutions. For example, if we assume that this Ex naught multiplied by cosine k naught z, if you make the same steps, we can find out Ex naught multiplied by cosine k naught z will satisfy this wave equation. If we are assuming that it is Ex dash sine k naught z and we make double derivative with respect to z, we will find that this would be satisfying the same equation. So till now, let us assume that we are assuming this solution. Okay, but actually we have other different solutions. The main important point that the two solutions are independent to each other. Okay, all right. Actually, with this solution, if we multiply it by e to the power j omega t to obtain the instantaneous electric field, so the field in this case would be proportional to e to the power j multiplied by omega t minus k naught z, which we have previously mentioned that is forward propagating wave. And the other function, if we multiplied it by the time dependence e to the power j omega t, so in this case The electric field would be proportion to e to the power j omega t plus k naught z, which we called it backward propagating function. So effectively, this is a solution of the phasor form of the forward propagating function, and this is a solution of the phasor form of the backward propagating function. So this is the general solution for the second differential equation. And as we mentioned, we have two functions, two independent functions. One would be the forward propagating function, and the other is backward propagating function. And the forward propagating function has an amplitude Ex naught, and the backward propagating function has an amplitude Ex naught dash. So assuming that if Ex naught dash is zero, so the field in this case, it would be only forward propagating function. If Ex naught is zero, so in this case, the wave would be only backward propagating function. Okay? Now, based on the phasor form of the electric field, we can find the corresponding phasor form of the magnetic field. This can be done by using Faraday's law of Maxwell's equation, which is the rotation of the electric field equals in the phasor form minus j omega mu naught h. To remind you, this was originally the rotation of the electric field was minus partial b by partial t. Partial by partial t is j omega b mu naught h. Okay? Please remember this. Okay, so now by taking the care of the x component, and we say that this x component is function only of z, and remember that the curl towards ax, ay, az, the derivative with respect to x, the derivative with respect to y, the derivative with respect to z, x component, y component, z component. So we don't have y, we don't have z, we have only x component. And we have only derivative with respect to z. So the derivative with respect to z appears only in the y component. So in this case, the curl operation can be simplified as the derivative with respect to z, the electric field of Ex as a phasor component, which is given here, equals minus j omega mu naught hys. Okay, so by taking the derivative of the obtained phasor form of the electric field, which we have obtained by solving this partial differential equation, or this differential equation, sorry, this differential equation. So by taking the derivative with respect to z, we can obtain the phasor form of the magnetic field. Now the derivative here, Ex is constant, e to the power minus j k naught z. To drive it with respect to z, it would be as multiplication by minus j k naught. And here the derivative with respect to z as multiplication by positive j k naught. So as we see, the derivative of Ex with respect to z would equal minus j omega mu naught hys, and we are going to take the derivative. So hys would be minus 1 over j omega mu naught multiplied by the derivative of the phasor form of Ex. So the derivative with respect to z here corresponds to minus j k naught, and the derivative with respect to z here would be positive j k naught. Now, by inserting minus 1 over j omega mu inside this bracket, and remember that k naught, it was omega multiplied by the square root of mu naught epsilon naught k naught equal k naught equal omega square root mu naught epsilon naught. So by inserting 1 over omega mu naught here, this minus will be eliminated with this minus, j will be eliminated with j. We have omega in the denominator and omega in the denominator, so the remaining would be square root of mu naught epsilon over mu naught. So we can say square root of epsilon over mu naught, right? Multiplied by E x naught multiplied by e to the power minus j k naught z. In a similar way, here we have minus, here positive, so it would be minus. J would be eliminated with j. K naught would be represented as omega square root mu naught epsilon naught. So omega will be eliminated with omega. And square root of mu naught epsilon naught over mu naught would be square root of epsilon over mu naught. And the minus, as we mentioned, because minus plus, alright? So this is a result of the phasor magnetic field in y direction in terms of the electric field component which you have obtained in their phasor form. Alright? And once again, this component would correspond to the forward propagating component, and this component would correspond to the backward propagating component. Effectively, this should equal hy naught in forward propagating function e to the power minus j k naught z plus h y naught dash multiplied by e to the power j k naught z. So in this case, h y naught, the amplitude of the magnetic field in the forward propagating wave would equal e x naught h y naught would equal Ex naught multiplied by the square root epsilon naught over mu naught, and H dash Y naught would equal minus Ex dash multiplied by square root epsilon naught over mu naught. Okay? If we are talking about the time domain form, it is very simple. We are going to multiply by e to the power j omega t and take the real value of this. So in this case, it would be Ex naught square root epsilon naught over mu naught. The real value of the exponential term, it would be cosine omega t minus k naught z for the forward, and for the backward, it would be cosine omega t plus k naught z. So if this is the phasor form of the magnetic field, this is an instantaneous form of Hy. So this is function of z and t. This is function of z only. Alright? Okay. So once again, we said that this is a phasor form of the magnetic field, which can be represented as Hy component in forward propagating direction plus h dash component in backward propagation constant, and this hy naught should equal this component, and this h dash should equal this component. So the relation between the electric field and the magnetic field for the forward propagating component, Ex naught would equal the square root of mu naught over epsilon naught hy naught. And effectively, this square root has the dimension of impedance. And we are going to define it as eta naught. So eta naught would equal square root of mu naught over epsilon naught, and because it has a dimension of impedance, we are going to call it the intrinsic impedance. And because this for free space, this is the intrinsic impedance of free space. So the relation between the magnitude of the electric field in the phase of four to the magnetic field in the phase of four, or in general, the relation between the electric field and the magnetic field in the plane wave is that the ratio of the electric field to the magnetic field equals what we are going to call the intrinsic impedance of the medium. And if we are in the free space, so this is the intrinsic impedance of free space. And this intrinsic impedance in free space equals 120 by ohms, or simply it can be represented as 377 ohms. Should be noted that it is not real impedance. You cannot find ohmmeter, for example, to measure the intrinsic impedance of the free space, but it is the relation of the magnitude of the electric field to the magnetic field in free space. On the other hand, if we look at the backward propagating function, we can note that the relation between the electric and magnetic field of the backward propagating function actually has the same value but with negative direction. So the phasor of the electric field in the backward propagating function equal minus eta naught multiplied by the phasor of the magnetic field of the backward propagating function. So in forward propagation, the electric field equal eta naught h, and for backward propagating, the electric field equals minus eta naught h, where eta naught is the intrinsic impedance of free space. Assuming that we are talking free space, if we are talking general media, it would be the intrinsic impedance of the medium. And the dimension of eta naught is in ohm, and is the ratio of the electric field to the magnetic field. And effective electric field is volt over meter, and the magnetic field ampere over meter. So the units of eta naught is volt over ampere, which is the unit of ohm. Okay, so according to this, we can understand that it would be quite enough to solve only the electric field in electromagnetic wave problem, because effectively the magnetic field is directly related to the electric field, especially in the case of plane wave, by the characteristic impedance or the intrinsic impedance, such that if I'm talking about in forward propagating field, the magnetic field would be the electric field over eta naught. And if I'm talking about backward propagating field, it would be the magnetic field equal the electric minus the electric field over eta naught. So we need to know the amplitude of the electric field, and we not only to know is it forward propagating or backward propagating. And once we know it is forward or backward, and by the knowledge of the intrinsic impedance of the media, we can obtain the magnetic field directly in this case. Okay? Alright.